without benefit of any camera tricks, is the result of a year's careful creation, preparation, and practice designed to bring us the epitome of the mystery of magic. Dramatic illusions which have never before been performed on television. Here now, in a triumph of both talent and style, is the magic of David Copperfield.
My name is David Copperfield. The first magic to have ever fascinated me wasn't only the Houdini kind, but also the Hollywood kind. I used to sit in movie theaters and fantasize that I was the hero who found himself in romantic situations with mysterious ladies. Well, tonight, I get a chance to live those fantasies, but with one extra dimension. Magic.
Thank you. lovely guest from WKRP in Cincinnati, Miss Lonnie Anderson.
You know, David, I'm a little surprised at you.
What did I do?
Well, you told me you were different from other men.
Well, that's true. I did say that.
Uh-huh. Well, then how come I found this hanging in your dressing room?
Well,
You said it was my mind that appealed to you.
No, I said, among other things, your mind appealed to me. But rather than me explaining, let me show you, okay? Now, in this poster, you're wearing a watch,
uh-huh.
a towel, and almost wearing a bathing suit. Now, I'm an illusionist. I do things differently than other men. Let me give you an example, okay?
Okay.
I don't normally wear a watch, but if I were to need a watch, all I'd have to do is roll this up into a little tube, just like this, reach inside, and pull out a watch.
Oh.
And if I were to need a towel, you see what's coming. Inside and pull out a towel.
Oh, well, that's just amazing, David, but what happens to the poster now?
Well, I'll show you. Is my watch on?
That's just terrific.
I think so. Let me give you another example.
Okay.
Okay? Let's imagine you and I were on a date.
Yes.
Parked on a deserted beach.
Yes.
With a full moon overhead.
Oh, yes.
And I were to say to you, let's go swimming.
Oh, no.
Why?
I don't have a swimsuit.
Exactly. Now, let's see what the poster looks like.
Oh, no, David. I know what the poster looks like now.
Oh, come on, Lonnie, you shouldn't be embarrassed. A good body's a blessing, and I'm sure everyone here would love to see what you're blessed with, wouldn't you?
Well, all right, David. I mean, after all, it is your show. There's just one little thing I'd like to take out.
Did I miss something?
Mm-hmm. Right here.
What is that?
This is a hair clip.
A hair clip?
Mm-hmm.
How does a young man of 22 become a giant in the mysterious world of magic? Well, you're going to get a good idea now as David Copperfield goes back in film history to create for us a magical vignette that reflects his special interests. He takes an Alfred Hitchcock film, The Unforgettable, To Catch a Thief, and a George Gershwin song, the equally unforgettable, Our Love is Here to Stay, and unites them in a magnificent, mysterious, and fantastic illusion. Here now, David Copperfield in The Jewel Thief. The incredible illusions of David Copperfield. Admiration for what David does. I have to confess, my real emotion is envy.
Envy? Bill, you're a magician and a good one. Why envy?
Well, because I'd like to do the kind of things that you do, and every time I try an illusion like that, it ends up in total disaster. I get so frustrated.
Well, we all get frustrated, Bill.
Yeah, but not like I do, David. You have no idea what I'm like when I become frustrated, angry.
Well, I can't imagine you like that.
You'd be amazed. I'm a changed man. I lose my composure. They say that my friends don't even recognize me. I turn into a Hulk.
Incredible.
That's only part of it, David. Right now, there's something else that's bothering me.
Look,
right there. It's this statement that I'm supposed to read from the cue card, huh? All the magic is performed live without any camera tricks.
Yes, but it's very important for the folks at home to know that.
Oh, I agree with that. I agree. But look, there's just too many unnecessary words there.
Well, Bill, I certainly defer to your judgment. Let me get the card and... Right, what changes would you like to make?
Well, first of all, there's something very demeaning about the word tricks. You do not perform tricks, David. You perform illusions.
Well, when you're right, you're right. Bill, let me just tear that word right off. Just like that. How's that?
Well, look, without any camera. I mean, if there were any camera, this would be a radio show. You don't need that. Okay. Well, of course, you are performing live, aren't you? I mean, otherwise, they wouldn't have given you an hour special of your own.
You're right. If I were dead, I'd only have a half hour.
But every week. All right. Now, David, look. Magic. I mean, magic is in the title of the show. That's what people tuned in to see. We don't need that.
May I?
Please. Thank you.
What's left?
All the? Which doesn't make very much sense.
You're right. Do you have any ideas?
Well, David, it's your show. I wouldn't want to interfere. Do you have any ideas?
Well, As it happens, I think I have something that'll be just right.
Oh. All the magic is performed live without any camera tricks.
Perfect. We'll be right back right after this commercial message from one of our sponsors.
How did you do that?
The best of time, Miss Valerie Bertinelli. Valerie is going to join me in an illusion a little later, but I asked her to come out now because of a conversation we had the other day. The subject, of course, was magic.
I had said that ever since I saw Tony Curtis in the movie Houdini, I'd been fascinated with escapes.
Well, one of the nice things about becoming a magician was that I got a chance to meet some of the men that I idolized as a boy. And one of the nice things about having your own TV show is the opportunity of having one of them as a guest. Here's an escape performed before your very eyes by my guest and my friend from London, England, Alan Allen.
We've persuaded two members of the security department to come on stage to tie me up in handcuffs and chains. Here are the handcuffs and chains. Now, the security. Now, go on them, make sure they're quite strong. Now, listen carefully. I want you both to tie me in the handcuffs and chains as tightly as you can in any way you like. Okay? This one goes on first. We lock that. Press downwards. No, it's not locked. Half. That's it. You want for the back, do you? Okay. It goes here. Good. Now, take the rest of the chain. Pull it as tightly as you can. Then lock it into another portion. Right now. Don't forget the arms as well. Try to tie the arms securely. Pull it tight. That's it. Pull it as tight as you can. Now we have slipping off there. Hold it. Bring it around the front. Now we have a lock for you to lock the end in place. Is it locked?
Locked.
Good. Well, gentlemen, I'm very grateful to you for your help. So now please return to your seats and watch the rest of the show from the front. Thank you very much indeed. Now I'll turn around and let you see how this is all fastened at the back. These gentlemen were very kind, so I must absolve them of all responsibility.
Alan Allen will be suspended upside down. The rope will be hoisted to the ceiling. This rope is covered with absorbent material. He's pouring gasoline and kerosene. While the rope is burning, Alan Allen will attempt to escape from the chains and handcuffs before the rope burns through. Seconds.
seconds. Seconds. 75 seconds. 80 seconds. 85 seconds.
Doing our illusions on the stage. But it's always fun to go right in the audience and get very close and use objects borrowed from the folks in the audience. So what I'd like to do is start out now by borrowing some keys. Whoever has keys on them, raise your hand if you have keys. You, sir, could I borrow your keys? Just throw them down to me when you get them out. Also, I'm going to need a ring. Now, you do have a nice ring there. I was wondering if, can you remove that ring?
Sure.
Can you throw the keys down? What I'm going to do is I'm going to take the keys and place them in my back pocket, just so everybody knows where they are, okay? I'm just going to put them back right back there, just like that. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to need to borrow your ring, all right? Just take it from you. Now, you would know this ring if you saw it, right?
Right.
Okay. Watch. We're going to get very close now. If I put that ring in between my two hands, just like this, it'll just seem to melt away. Just like that. And watch very closely now, because if we look back here, there should be, like, the ring. Is that your ring?
Oh. Yep.
Thank you. Mr. Robert Stack, ladies and gentlemen. Robert Stack.
Show you something, but rather than borrow items from you, people may think that's prearranged. I'd like to borrow some things from other people, and I'll perform something for you. Do you have some change on you? Just pull out your change in your pocket and hold it in your hand. Pick out one coin. Does anybody have a cigarette and a lighter over here? Well, just take out a cigarette, just so we don't think that anything is gimmicked or so forth. You can take one out, yes, and also hand him the lighter too. I don't want to touch anything. All right, super.
Yeah, I don't smoke. It's good.
Yes. Well, neither do I, but it's for the show. You
yeah,
know?
Of course.
Okay. If we can just pick out one of those coins, and if we can get a close-up of that coin, just to make sure that the same coin that you're giving me is the exact same coin we're going to use. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take the coin, and if I could take the cigarette from you, if I hold the cigarette right up to the quarter like that, it'll almost seem to be sticking to it just like that. And if we keep turning it, the quarter will almost seem to be penetrated by the cigarette. Could you light the lighter for just a moment? I don't smoke, but again, it's for effect, you know. You may have relatives in the old country? Okay. Now, here's the best part. If we can get really close for this, if you watch as I take the cigarette out, this quarter will almost seem to be sealing itself up.
Oh, just fantastic. Yes.
Have you ever seen a quarter that allows a cigarette to go through it?
No, I haven't seen one this week like that.
There's no such thing.
No such thing.
Ladies and gentlemen, Robert Stack.
One 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. What is your bad bags on? Join me, hon. We'll have some fun when the clock strikes one. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. We're gonna rock, rock, rock. Go for broad daylight. We're gonna rock, gonna rock around the clock tonight. When the clock strikes 2, 3 and 4,
I'd like to show you something with four items from inside your refrigerator. An orange, a lemon, an egg, and a canary. Thank you. Not all of my illusions are created around memories of old movies. There are other kinds of memories. Like the other day, I was cleaning out the attic, and I ran across a whole box full of memories. One of them was a photograph of an old friend of mine. I haven't seen her in quite a while. Memories are very important, because sometimes they're all you have left.
Created by writers like Raymond Chandler, Dashiell Hammett, and Ross MacDonald, and brought to life by actors like Humphrey Bogart, Dick Powell, and Alan Ladd. They simply and cynically handled every mystery that came their way. Tonight, and I remind you again that this is done without any camera tricks, David Copperfield adds another mystery, magic. In this amazing display of his mastery of the art of illusion, here again, the magic of David Copperfield.
The city was closed up for the night. Only the rats and the hoods were still on the hustle, and me. I'm Slim Suede, a Seamus, a gumshoe, a private eye. I was starting my latest case.
A real classy sister from Park Avenue thought she was being followed and needed my protection. She was hiding out in a two-story walk-up in Soho. It was a little late for a social call, but I could see that her light was still on. So I decided to climb the stairs and pay her a visit. Her bedtime when I arrived. But she was gone. This was more than I bargained for. I knew I hadn't missed her by much. The sheets were still warm. Always known for my quick thinking, I searched for her. Shagging for clues, I found myself in an old warehouse in the garment district. Now there was a suspicious character, if ever I saw one. Maybe this was the man who was following her. The trail was really getting hot, and I was just about to nab him when the trail got hotter. Boy, did she need protection. She was all curves, more sections than the Sunday paper. I've heard you can learn a lot from body language, and she was teaching me plenty. Someone was out to kidnap her and grab a big ransom from her wealthy father. I promised I'd keep an eye on her. And if the kidnapper didn't show, well, a magician's got to have some fun too, you know? I was busy comforting her when I heard a gunshot. I told her to hide until I checked out the situation. It was only the backfire from an old jalopy. I came back to comfort her some more. But she was nowhere to be seen. What a chump. It was a setup all along. The old dust in the eyes game. Well, Mrs. Suede didn't raise any children loony enough to trust hunches. But this case was giving me a real strange feeling. Still, I think I know where the answer is. Right under my nose. They made one mistake. They got me mad. Whoever glommed onto her was sure to leave a ransom note. That's when he showed up again. This time I was ready to play the game his way. I'd just hide out and wait for his next move. Now I was ready. Ready to grab him so fast he'd swallow his teeth. This was the man she was afraid of. This was the man who was following her all along. They say a criminal always returns to the scene of the crime. Well, in this case, they were right. Suddenly, all the pieces of the puzzle fit together. And what a picture it made! She was the criminal, staging her own kidnapping to collect the ransom from her father. How did I know all this? That's easy. Because the man who was following her was me. It was an open and shut case, sweetheart. With good behavior, she'd be out in 2 years. She was bad. She was dangerous. And her family had money. This could be the start of a beautiful friendship. To say thank you. First to my wonderful guests, Bill Bixby, Lonnie Anderson, Valerie Bertinelli, and Robert Stack. I also would like to thank the most important part of a magic show,
the audience, both here and at home. And before I leave, there is one bit of unfinished business.
For Walter Matthau in House Calls. Meet Dr. Charles Nichols, America's greatest operator.
Hi, I'm Dr. Nichols.
What advice would you have for a young person who wants to go into medicine?
My advice is always the same and always simple. Marry money.
Glenda Jackson, Art Carney, and Richard Benjamin also star in House Calls, the CBS Wednesday night movie. Coming up next, right after news break.